Med Department of Nutrition and Dean Administration. Dr. Meena Patange started her career as the head of the Department of Nutrition at St. Anne's College, Medipatnam, in the year 1988 and was instrumental in establishing the department. Under her headship, the department grew from 30 students and one faculty to 400 students and 7 faculty members. The department offers master's program, PG diploma, and undergraduate program. She is also responsible for establishing the Eco Learning Center at St. Anne's College and coordinator for the same. Ma'am was awarded the State Best Teacher Award by the Government of Telangana on 5th September 2018. Mrs. Meena was conferred honorary doctorate by the University of South America. She has presented and published papers in various international and national conferences and scientific journals and has been invited to chair sessions at conferences of IDA and various other institutions. She has undertaken several research projects funded by various institutions, including UGC. She has addressed numerous audiences on various topics of food and nutrition at several organizations. Ma'am has held the position of Vice President of Indian Dietetic Association AP chapter and has been on the Board of Studies and Chief Examiner for Usmania University and various autonomous colleges. Ma'am also has been a member of steering committee of the college for 3 cycles. May I now invite Dr. Meena. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Sarita, for that long introduction and a very good morning to all the participants. It's such a pleasure to have you all with us to attend this webinar on NAC accreditation. Thank you very much. We are having a wonderful morning here in Hyderabad because of the showers of blessing as mentioned by Dr. Smita Asthana. I hope whoever and wherever you are living right now, you are also having a very pleasant weather. Now, I'm going to deal today, as you all know, about the criteria for infrastructure and learning resources. Now, if I have to put it in a nutshell, I can say that infrastructure and learning resources can be summed up in just a couple of words. What is it all about? Building, books, and computers and their maintenance. And my session is over. Thank you. But it's not as simple as that. But one thing in the beginning, I want to say that at the outset, for whether it is an autonomous college or is it a affiliated college or a PG college or a college which is only handling undergraduate courses, the SSR, the questionnaire regarding criteria 4 remains the same. There is no difference in for any of the criteria that I've mentioned. Let me just look at the slideshow and make it bigger. Full screen. Yeah. So overview, when you look at the criteria 4, it is all dealing with what kind of infrastructure is available in the institution for delivering quality education, because this matters a lot. And then second most important thing is how the students and staff benefit from the infrastructure that is being provided by any kind of institution, and how from providing, not only providing it, but are these infrastructure facilities being maintained well, and are we adding something or the other to the infrastructure year after year. Now this 100 marks are allotted for infrastructure and learning resources, and out of this there are four main aspects. As I said, the building is physical facilities, the books is a part of library, the IT infrastructure, computers and other paraphernalia, and how well we are maintaining all these campus facilities. So everything put together amounts to 100 marks. Now, as we all know, physical facilities are very, very important for creating the right kind of ambience for teaching learning process and academic enhancement of a student. So for this physical facilities to be present in a right manner, adequate infrastructure facilities are keys in order to deliver efficient education. And not only just the physical facilities for academic purpose, but also when a student comes to a particular institution, we are looking at the overall personality development of the student. Now, this personality development comes up with the student participating in various sports, games, and other cultural activities, because the 3 years of life or the 5 years of life, including his PG, the student spends in a particular institution is a memorable time. So not only in terms of academics, but also in the personal growth. So therefore, the other facilities, supporting facilities, such as the sports and games, and also the cultural facilities that we provide for these activities are very important. Then apart from that, the both the physical facilities and the facilities provided for sports and games need to be growing. As we all know that we are very proud to say that last year my admissions were so many, 5 years ago my admissions were so many, but now I have many more. But are we keeping in tune with the growth of the number of students in terms of all our infrastructure facilities? Then apart from this, the most important is, if we want to grow along with our students in terms of infrastructure, we also need to have certain amount of provision made in our annual budget. So when we are talking about infrastructure, everything, as we go further in my slides, you will realize we are going to talk also about the expenditure part of it and what is the kind of allotment which is being made. Now, first and foremost, coming to the physical facilities, we need to have everything listed, all the physical facilities related to the academic purpose have to be listed here. As you can see, I've put the entire detailed list, but let me tell you, whatever, I think everybody has classrooms, seminar halls, labs, etc. But it is from our point of view, what is not there right now in your educational institutions, you need to add on those. Such as, most important, as we have seen in the last three cycles of NAC that we have undergone, more emphasis is given not only to the academic physical facilities, but also certain specialized facilities, such as those which are environment friendly, those which promote the green concept on the campus. So such as what? Such as solar lamps, or you have a rain harvesting pit, you have a vermicomposting, you have a wastage composting, wastage recycling, incinerator. Such kind of things are given more emphasis by the NAC team. Therefore, apart from the regular physical features that all of us have in our institutions, one needs to build up on what all just now I spoke. Now, in the first question, they ask us to describe all the physical facilities in about 500 words. It needs to be documented. So how it needs to be documented? It is much easier if you follow a tabular column system, where first you start with the number of classrooms, what are the kind of dimensions that you have of the classrooms, how many students can be seated, and you number the classrooms, all the classrooms. And the naming of the labs, you have certain innovative, creative names. If you anytime happen to visit our college, you will see that each and every facility that we have in the college, from our labs to our centralized research center, they are very, very uniquely named, because the purpose of naming is to have a connection with the subject that we are teaching. And at the same time, the student needs to connect that, yes, I am learning nutrition, I am learning chemistry, and the lab is named after a famous scientist, a famous personality dealing with a Nobel Prize winner in chemistry. So we need to have certain unique names, and we also have to have everything documented, botanical garden, animal houses. So if you do not have such facilities, kindly build up on these, and then that is going to add a lot of value to your SSR. Now, moving on to the cultural facilities and the sports facilities, this also, they need the description to be given in 500 words. And mainly, you need to talk about, for cultural facilities, you have an indoor auditorium or an outdoor auditorium, or if certain colleges do not have an auditorium, they may be renting an auditorium for their annual functions. So even that needs to be mentioned. Now, what is that 500 words going to be made up of? The 500 words that we are talking about is all about the description of the facility, the number of occasions on which that facility is going to be utilized, and its size, its area, when did we establish, or when did you establish rather, and how often is it going to be used, and how many people or how many students are going to use it. So it's not that you have a big stadium built over there without having any activities being shown. So what you need to concentrate on is the how frequently or how often is this facility being utilized, and by how many students. So what information that you need to upload is made up of all the floor plans, the diagrams, the list of equipment available. Apart from the 500 words, you need to document these. Now, other thing, most important part of infrastructure for academic purpose is UGC or NAC is interested in knowing what kind of ICT facilities are available on the campus. Now, I need not emphasize the role of ICT in today's life. Just an example of how we are able to connect with nearly 300 plus participants on this webinar. So, to go further, unless and until we provide such kind of facilities for our students, there is no point, because the younger generation is what has to move along and grow along. Therefore, in this, what do we need to give? Number of classrooms with LCD facility. Then what are the kind of number of classes that you have with smart classrooms? What is a smart classroom? Something where you have a interactive board installed and with an internet Wi-Fi facility, and a teacher, when she is teaching, can this interactive board is very, very handy, and it's a wonderful tool of teaching. And then how many classrooms are provided with Wi-Fi or LAN facilities, and number of seminar halls. So basically, UGC is interested, or the NAC is interested in knowing how much of ICT is available in your college in terms of utilizing it for teaching learning process of the students, as well as academic enhancement of the faculty. Now, there is a formula given in one of the data templates, so where all this information that we are providing will be utilized. Now, what are the documents that are needed for verification of this? Now, they look at, it's not just writing a description in 500 words, but or providing a tabular column. You need to have a proof in the form of geotagged photographs of each and everything that we are claiming in the documents. So if we say that we have 40 classrooms on the campus, you need to have, and out of that, if 10 classrooms are provided with Wi-Fi and the LCD, you need to have the pictures of all the 10 classrooms, all the seminar halls, and then geotag them. Put them up on your website and provide a link to the during your SSR. Now, you need to consider only classrooms or seminar halls with ICT-enabled facilities. No other classroom. And all classrooms used for only academic purpose should be considered. Now, if you are using a classroom for, say, examination purpose with an ICT facility, that is not considered, but only for academic purpose. Now, what is not to be included is any labs or workshop which have ICT is not to be included as part of this particular metric. Now, there is a certain data template attached to this particular question. As you can see, or you give the list of room numbers, type of ICT facility in each room number, and provide a link to the geotagged photographs, as I mentioned earlier. Now, apart from in the infrastructure also, we not only providing of infrastructure, but as I said, the budget, what kind of provision is the institution making for the augmentation of the infrastructure facilities. Now for that, you need to upload audited utilization certificates, documents or statements signed by the principal as well as the chartered accountant of the college. There is a formula for calculating this, and we'll go further to the data template. Now this data template, very clearly it is given what is the budget allocated for infrastructure augmentation. Augmentation means addition. It is not maintenance. Maintenance is separate, and augmentation or addition. Suppose you had 2 years ago 30 classrooms for teaching, but in the last 2 years, every year you have added extra 5 classrooms. So that comes under augmentation. So what is the budget spent for augmentation? You need to complete it in the data template. Now, this is it exactly. When we are talking about augmentation, construction, furniture, LCD or interactive boards, any new equipment, not the repair or maintenance of old equipment, but any new equipment which is added. And what you need to provide here is the bills, the scanned copies, all this needs to be uploaded as a documentation, and you need to have the hard copies for the physical inspection. Now, this is going further, emphasizing on augmentation. There is a metric given, and this metric also very clearly mentions that it is all about infrastructure augmentation only, and highlight when you are providing the consolidated fund allocation in the budget. As I said, the statements have to be signed by principal and the CA of the college. Then highlight only the relevant items in the audited income and expenditure. What has been added? Highlight those. Now, what needs to be avoided or not, it is not going to be considered, is recurring expenditure on lab and maintenance and acquisition of books and journals. Now, the next important facility to be seen or key indicator is the library. We all agree that a college is not a college without the learning resources in terms of the books, the journals in the library. So, to give an overview, what we have to fill up or what we need to give information is in terms of the library holdings, in terms of books, journals and other learning materials, as well as technology aided learning mechanisms. Then we second aspect they are looking is, how are you moving along with the time in terms of ICT, even with respect to the library? So have you started automating your library facility? Is it digitized? How are you taking care of the accession of books or entry of books, and how are you keeping track of the issues and the borrowings and the returns? So automation of the library is very, very important, and they need more information on this. And most important is not only providing these facilities, but how many children, how many students, and how many faculty members are utilizing? We spend lakhs and lakhs of rupees on books, journals, and e-resources every being raised to the extent by the stakeholders. So that is what is the information we need to provide. And this is in the form of this particular slide. The data requirement regarding the automation has to be provided in for the last 5 years. And what is the nature? The details are what is the nature of automation? Is your library fully or partially? And what is the kind, what software are you using? What is the version? What is the year of automation you need to provide? And all the documents pertaining to the automation need to be uploaded. Now, the most important thing for today or in the coming years is, as you also may have seen, how much ever we talk about the physical books being available in the library, a child or a student has an option of referring electronic media for all his resources. Now, everywhere the e-resources are provided, we have an access to e-journals, and show this, the government websites or the databases provided by the government in the form of a compilation of all the resources, show the Sindhu, show the Ganga, e-books and databases. So what we need to fill up in our SSR is how many of these facilities are we making it available to our students? And the options are given here. And depending upon each option, the marks are allotted. And what are the details of the subscription we need to upload? Moving on further. Now, institutional subscription, they want to know as to, one second. Sorry for that, my battery was running low. Now moving on further, the e-resources of the institution in terms of the data that is required of every year for the past 5 years, it is in the form of a data template. Now, what are the documents that are needed? The documents that are needed are the e-copy of the letter of subscription, whichever you are subscribing to, whatever database you're subscribing to, whatever source you're subscribing, and screenshots of the facilities claimed, and specific details with respect to e-resources which are selected. And this, we need to provide a link to all these sources so that it is put up on the website. But if in the library you have soft copies of any books, it cannot be accepted as an e-resource. Now, there is one more thing you must have seen here, remote access to e-resources. Now, in our college, we subscribe to a lot many e-resources, and students are given information of the availability of these e-resources on the notice board of the library. Now from there, the students can come to the librarian and they will be given a personal password. So this is how whoever is interested. So we need the NAC wants to know how many students are accessing these e-resources. Now, one more thing is, what is a kind of, again, there are, when we come to infrastructure, we are always relating it to the allocation in the budget. So coming to the library also, the same case, how much of budget is allocated, how much of amount is allocated in the budget for the purchase of books and e-resources, as well as the journals that we want to purchase, and how much is not only allotted, but how much is actually spent. So therefore, the audited statement of accounts of annual expenditure for purchase of books and e-journals in the last 5 years is the data which we need to provide. And what are the verification they want? What kind of documents? They want consolidated extract of naturally expenditure for purchase of books only from the audited statements. Now, apart from the budget, as I said earlier, the NAC wants to know how many students are accessing the library physically as well as the in the remote sense of the e-resources. So you need to have some method of computing this data. It can be in the form of physical registers, or you can have biometrics installed in the library which automatically records the number of footfalls in the library. It can be the footfalls of teachers, it can be the footfalls of students, and we need to upload the last page of the accession. They are very, very particular. Whatever we are claiming, is it genuine or not? So the data requirement is the in the form of accession register they want, and they want to know the methodology. And in the data template, there is a what we call a formula which is used to give marks. Now, what are the documents required? Yeah, the third most important key indicator is the IT infrastructure. And with respect to IT infrastructure, first and foremost is they would like to know the kind of Wi-Fi connections or internet connections that you have, the bandwidth. So as you can see, there are options given here, and the more bandwidth that you show, the more marks are allotted. Very clearly it is mentioned. And what is the data requirement is the bills for the last 5 years. So can you we go ahead? Yes. Now the data, one other thing they want to know, as we all been talking about the technology and the importance of technology with respect to education and learning, how many computers are provided? So this is in ratio in terms of number of students and number of computers. Now, it is not merely that you can borrow some computers and put it in the physical, you know, college when the team is going to come. No way. It's very, very difficult in terms of you need to provide your stock registers, your bills for purchase of computers, and number of computers available. All this has to be taken in the form of scanned copies, and this need to be uploaded. And what is not to be included is you have, say, 10 computers in your office. Those computers are not to be counted. If you have computers for various faculty rooms, those computers are also not to be counted. But what are the also not considered is computers which are purchased after the latest completed academic year. Only in the previous years, what has been provided, what is available, we need to provide that data. So next slide. Rajeshwari. Yeah, so what are the documents for verification? What is the internet plan? What is the speed, the bandwidth of the higher education institution? And e-copy of the document bills for 1 month, for any 1 month, because they want it random, not the latest, but any 1 month. And here what is considered is only the leased line connection in the name of the higher education institution. What is not considered is the snapshot of the speed test. So all of us know that we at home also we do the speed test. So that is I think, you know, one of the most, it sounds very juvenile to us, but I'm sure many institutions have been doing that, and that is the reason they get to mention that it is not considered. Now, the next slide. Yes, the fourth important key indicator is not only having facilities, but is sufficient, but how it is maintained year after year, in what condition, how much of provision is made in the budget, annual budget, for maintenance. And the third most important point, which is going to be covered under infrastructure maintenance, and one of the last points is the provision for what the policies the institution is adopting for maintaining the quality of its infrastructure, the usage by the students. So let us just look at it one by one. Next slide. Can I request?
Yeah, it just takes 10 seconds.
Yes. Now, maintenance of campus infrastructure in terms of budget for building, furniture, it's very clear. See, when we come to infrastructure and learning resources, there is no ambiguity in the questions at all. Very, very clearly mentioned. So when we are talking about maintenance, they have mentioned that building maintenance, painting, repairs, furniture, old furniture made into new furniture, equipment in the labs, computers, vehicles, and then annual maintenance contracts. Whatever the college is spending, we need to show it over here under maintenance. And we need to provide audited income and expenditure statements. And focus is mainly on the maintenance of physical and academic support facilities. Just a statement of last 5 years on data metrics is not going to be sufficient. Yes. Yeah, this is the expenditure they want, how much the institution has spent in the previous 5 years on the maintenance of campus infrastructure. And definitely everywhere when we are showing in the budget on expenditure on books, expenditure on augmentation and expenditure on maintenance, we should not consider the salary. It is only the non-salary expenditure which is incurred. And here you need to update or upload the audited statements. Again, always any audited statement, I repeat, has to be signed by the principal as well as the certified chartered accountant whose officially name, address, everything is given. Yes. This is one of the most last but not the least important aspects of infrastructure, that is the policies, usage, maintenance and usage policies. So what are we talking about? If we are talking about a building, how is it maintained? How do you maintain the electrical appliances? How do you maintain the entire building structure? So how often is it? Annually, is it painted? Once in 5 years, is it painted? The repairs are done once in 6 months. What kind of contract you have? Who is your contractor to carry out this kind of work? I'm just giving an example of the building, but that is at a bigger picture. Coming to the labs, what kind of lab equipment maintenance are you proposing? And how often your equipment is maintained? And what are the policies of usage? How is the equipment issued to the children and how the equipment is being utilized by them in the lab? So the usage and maintenance policies. I just give an example that in our college, we have a microbiology lab, we have chemistry lab. So in the chemistry lab, the chemicals, how are we disposing the chemicals after the children do their experiments? That is also a part of usage policy. Then my microbiology, are they using fumigation process to maintain their labs free of any kind of the microbial infestation? So these are the two examples that I've given. Or in the sports department, how do they maintain the gym? How often is it cleaned? Who is responsible for cleanliness? This is on a day-to-day basis, but you may be having a particular department which takes care of maintenance. So you have to start from the top and go to the bottom. So this is about maintenance and usage policies. So here I come to the end of my presentation. And sorry for the inconvenience caused with the break. And any questions that you have, most welcome to take them.
Yeah, good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes, Rajeshwari.
Ma'am, we have received few questions from our chat box, ma'am.
Okay.
There is a question from PV Radha Lakshmi. Can we have donated books to access and register? Can we enter?
Yes, you can have a separate entry for under the category of donated books, and definitely they will not be a part of the expenditure on books. That should be very clearly mentioned. You can have, definitely, but then that category has to be maintained and mentioned separately.
Yeah, ma'am. One more question from Vanita. What are simple things we can do to improve score marks?
Simple things that we can do to score marks. See, if it was simple and if marks are connected to it, nobody will give us marks for simple things. NAC is expecting us to do a lot more, put in a lot of effort and do a lot of hard work. So in terms of, your question is very broad-based. If it is related to infrastructure, then you need to have a user manual for every subject labs. That is something that I want to tell you, that those are the simple things. You have instructions in the form of posters in your labs for the students. That becomes a part of your documentation for maintenance and usage. Then you have identify certain, if you do not have right now, identify a certain group of people who are going to be in charge of maintenance and usage. So these are the kind of things. And then you have a separate committee which takes care of purchase and building up on infrastructure. So these are the very simple things which, you know, once you form these committees and allot the work, it becomes a big thing. And then you can show it in your, of course, in your SSR. But nothing comes free, nothing is simple. We have to understand that.
Yeah, ma'am. One more question. If good facilities are not there, what to do?
See, good facilities are not there, what to do? Whatever facilities you have, you need to build up on that. You have seen the detailed presentation I have given. Whatever is not there, today we can make a fresh start. So you can add on. You can add on to whatever you have. And it is the collective effort. It is not an individual effort, but it's a collective effort of the management as well as the faculty. And you can have a student committee which also helps you in improving the infrastructure facilities.
Yeah, ma'am. One more question. How to strengthen library facilities?
Yeah, library is nothing but books, journals, and e-resources. So as I have mentioned, if you haven't got the funding for purchase of more and more books, you try to look for e-resources, which like Show the Ganga, Show the Sindhu, which are the government provided ones where the fee is not needed. And there are certain private databases where you need to subscribe. And the subscription is also not very expensive. So nowadays, keeping our student needs in mind that they can access all the learning resources from the electronic media, you try to strengthen your electronic resources or e-resources in terms of books and journals and databases, and inform your students that these are available day to day, on and on, and publicize it and let that how you're publicizing, how many students are using, need to be shown in your SSR. And it's never too late. Always we have time. All of us, most of us, those who are going for NAC, we start our preparation a year or two ahead of that. So we can always put in more efforts to strengthen our library also and have certain library activities involving the students as well as form a small library committee who can take care of promoting the library resources and encourage the footfalls into the library.
Yeah, ma'am. Again, one more question from related to library. If there is no regular librarian in GDC, how will it impact score?
No, there has to be a librarian, or as I said, maybe whatever is the policy of the institution, you all have to sit together and have a small committee, if not a librarian, certain knowledgeable people who are made in charge of the library and take care of various functions in of the library.
Yeah, there is a question from Nirmala Kumari. Is it possible to go for NAC without having own building and other infrastructure facilities?
Let them answer whether they are from a government college or a private institution.
Yeah, Nirmala Kumari ma'am, please answer. You are from government institution or private? Please put it in the chat box your answer.
Okay, now let me just answer anyway broadly that if it is if it's a government institution, of course it's very difficult if they do not have, but whatever is there, and I'm sure that even the government expects the teachers who are present in the institution to work towards NAC. So you need to be totally united, you need to have a common goal of applying for NAC and working towards NAC. I'm sure later on you're going to hear a very nice inspirational talk by Dr. Smita Asthana as to how we all have to, you know, put in more effort and more for it, is because we are working for a common goal of a student's future. So if it is a government institution, you all have to be together and have one common goal. If it is a private institution, then also it is the management which has to think about if they want the institution to go for NAC and get a good rating, then it's the responsibility of the management also to have inputs in terms of building infrastructure and making it more stronger. If not in the next 1 year, maybe they can take a little more time and build up on whatever they want to achieve.
Yeah, ma'am. There is a question from Dr. Akiraju. Please give a few examples for library activities.
Yes, library activities that can be conducted are plenty. And a few examples only I can give you. For example, like library and the library committee organizing a quiz for students. That is one activity. Or a quiz or an activity of, you know, having the library holdings, where the location, etc., plus having book exhibitions, organizing book exhibitions, certain competitions for students related to the books, and say, you know, have a regular book clubs, reading clubs, along with the library committee. So these are the few examples. When we think, sit and think in a constructive manner, we get more activities in our mind and we can implement those.
Yeah, ma'am, again related to library, is it necessary to maintain separate departmental library?
Yes, definitely it is necessary to maintain a separate, I'm sorry I didn't mention that because one of the questions nowhere it is given, but it is always preferable to have a departmental library to be shown, because see, it is for two purposes. One, for the faculty purpose, that, you know, we have an immediate access to books. And second is, if any student, when we have given them some assignment or any other thing, if they're not able to have access in the college library, we can create a space, or we do have a accession register for departmental library. We should maintain a issue register for departmental library and make one of the faculty members in charge of the departmental library, where the books are not given on an overnight basis to the student, but the books are given for a day. They can come, issue it in the morning, do their work, and while going home, return back the book.
Yeah, ma'am. There is a question from Hajit Prasad. What are the main documents for submitting for NAC for private institution? are in the initial process of submission?
Ma'am has already answered. There is a session, the session which all of you are going to enjoy a lot on documentation, where all the details for of documentation from the centralized to the departmental level will be given, orientation will be given by Dr. Smita Asthana on the last day.
Yeah, ma'am. One more question. How does the lab equipment is disposed if it is not in use on time?
Yes, there is definitely, if it is redundant, if it is not going to be used, there is a certain, every institution has a certain method. Say, for example, in our college, we annually or once in 2 years, we collect all that is not being used. And since we have a sister in charge in the office, we and the department head gives the list of things which are available and to the office. And from there, they will dispose it off in whichever best manner. They may have a contractor for disposing of all the unused and redundant material. And we get a list signed and authorized by the sister in charge that this is the equipment which has been, which is identified as redundant and which has been disposed of. And we maintain that list in our stock register.
Yeah, ma'am, there is a question from physical education. Just they are asking about the points regarding general physical education department, ma'am.
See, physical education department is very, very important. And in our college, it is one of the backbones of the institution and in maintaining the quality of our college. So we need to have, of course, a physical director for the physical, this sports and games department, and that person is in charge. And we also make provision for the sports and games in our timetable regularly, so that students are made to go. And the sports department also offers certain add-on courses, and they of course conduct training programs on a regular basis, and they also conduct inter-class competitions as well as then they choose the students and participate in the inter-college and inter-university events. So strengthening starts from having a physical directress and an attender or two, and getting the equipment that is necessary for the physical education department, if not in a large amount, in a small amount, so that, if you know, it is there in every child to be active in sports and games. Say, if not, you don't have a big ground, develop your indoor games in terms of chess or table tennis or badminton court, a small court. You don't need a big court. So you can have indoor activities and get your students interested like that. And then when you see more number of students are visiting, then you can request for a bigger facility.
I think one more question also related to physical education. I think you would have answered how to improve overall physical education department.
Yeah, this is what I told, no? Starting from having a physical PD to, you know, a small facility, then make it slowly bigger. Because things don't happen overnight, no? We need to work and put our efforts into it.
Yeah. Again, one more question from library, ma'am, related to library. Is there any problem to maintain the old or outdated books in the library?
No, there is no... what do we call problem, but there is something called as, I think if you're a librarian, you know about the weeding out of the books, like we talked about the redundancy of the equipment. Similar way in library also, there is a procedure called as weeding out of the books. So if you have old books which are, you know, not being referred any longer for the last, there is a scientific method which is followed by all the libraries. So that weeding out process has to be implemented and go according to that process.
Again, few questions related to library, ma'am. In this age of e-books, how do we encourage students to visit the library physically? That is the first question. And the second one, how to increase the visitors to the library? Almost same.
It's more or less the same. As I said, having a committee, library committee, and the library committee should have more number of students in that library committee. And encourage the students to plan out a year-long activities related to the, make your presence felt that, that there is something called as a library and what are the activities which are undertaken by the library. Our library also undertakes the community activity where they go out and every year they donate certain dictionaries, certain stationery, etc. So therefore, it is the librarian's initiative to have a committee with more a few senior faculty and more number of students and chalk out a plan for throughout the year for library activities and publicize those activities in the college so that more and more students, that way you attract them and then they start getting used to borrowing books.
Yeah, ma'am. Thank you. How many library hours are needed for the student?
There is absolutely no compulsion, I think, but we do make a provision in our college weekly minimum 1 to 2 classes, minimum I'm saying. Some of the subjects like social sciences, there are more number of hours allotted for library, but minimum 1 to 2 hours per week need to be allotted.
Yeah. There is one more question from Dr. Vijay Kumar. 2 cycles completed as affiliated college from 15-16. We got autonomous status. Now they are in third cycle. My question is whether it is third cycle or first cycle of autonomous.
Already I responded to that.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Fine.
Active infrastructure planning for higher educational institutions is an important factor that creates positive and conducive atmosphere for a student's learning. Infrastructure plays a vital role in the education sector. Classroom design, auditoriums, laboratories, campus area, etc. are crucial elements of a learning environment and have a huge impact on students' academic growth. I extend my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Meena Patange for enlightening us on infrastructure insights. Thank you, ma'am, for that wonderful session.